The Changing Face of Doctor Who. The cover illustration portrays the third Doctor Who, whose physical appearance was altered by the Time Lords when they banished him to the planet Earth in the 20th century. Doctor Who and the Auton Invasion by Terrance Dicks. Read by Caroline John. Chapter 1, Prologue. Exile to Earth. In the High Court of the Time Lords, a trial was coming to its end. The accused, a renegade Time Lord known as the Doctor, had already been found guilty. Now it was time for the sentence. The Doctor looked very out of place, standing amongst the dignified Time Lords in their long white robes. To begin with, he was quite a small man. He wore an ancient black coat and a pair of check trousers. He had a gentle, rather comical face and a shock of untidy black hair. But there was strength in that face too, and keen intelligence in the blue eyes. A hush fell as the president of the court rose and began to speak.
Doctor, you have been found guilty of two serious offences against our laws. First, you stole a TARDIS and used it to roam through time and space as you pleased.
Nonsense, said the Doctor indignantly. I didn't steal it, just borrowed it for a while.
The president ignored the interruption.
More important, you have repeatedly broken our most important law. Interference in the affairs of other planets is a serious crime.
Again the Doctor interrupted.
I not only admit my interference, I am proud of it. You just observed the evil in the galaxies. I fight against it.
We have accepted your plea, Doctor, that there is evil in the universe which must be fought. You still have a part to play in that great struggle.
At once the Doctor began to look hopeful.
You mean you're going to let me go?
Not entirely. We have noted your interest in the planet Earth. You have visited it many times. You must have special knowledge of that world and its problems.
I suppose I have, agreed the Doctor.
You will be sent to Earth in the 20th century time zone. You will remain there for as long as we think proper. And for that time, the secret of the TARDIS will be taken from you.
The Doctor was indignant.
You can't condemn me to exile on one primitive planet in one particular time.
The president's voice was cold.
We can and we do. That is the verdict of this court.
A new thought struck the Doctor.
Besides, I'm known on Earth already. It could be most embarrassing for me.
Your appearance has changed before. It will change again. That is part of your sentence.
The Doctor continued to protest.
You can't just change what I look like without asking me.
You will have an opportunity to choose your new appearance, said the President patiently. Look.
As if by magic, a huge screen appeared on one wall of the court. Upon it, the Doctor saw a wide variety of faces and forms. At once, the Doctor started to make trouble. He rejected each one with the utmost scorn.
Too thin. Too fat. Ah, too young. Too old. No, I certainly don't want to look like that, I can tell you.
The president of the court sighed. They were letting the fellow off lightly. He ought to be humble and grateful, not kick up all this fuss.
You are wasting time, Doctor, said the president. Since you refuse to take the decision, we shall take it for you. The doctor made no secret of his indignation.
"Well, I've got a right to decide what I'm going to look like," he grumbled. "They attach a great deal of importance to these things on Earth. I mean, it's not my fault if this is the best you can do, is it? I've never seen such a terrible-looking bunch."
Ignoring the doctor's protests and complaints, the president sent a thought impulse to a fellow Time Lord who sat at a nearby control panel. The Time Lord's fingers moved swiftly over the rows of buttons. Immediately, the doctor was held in the grip of a force field. Unable to move, he felt the entire courtroom dissolve round him into a sort of spinning blackness. Sam Seeley moved through Oxley Woods like a rather tubby ghost. Sam was the most expert poacher for miles around, and proud of it. Many a time he'd slip by within inches of a watching gamekeeper. Soundlessly he moved through the woods, stopping from time to time to check his rabbit traps. He mopped the sweat from his brow as he moved along. No business to be as hot as this, not in October. Worse than a midsummer night it was. Seeley blamed it on those atom bombs. Suddenly, a fierce whizzing and hissing filled the air around him. Terrified, Seeley dropped to the ground, muffling his head in his poacher's sack. The terrifying noise continued. He heard soft, thumping sounds, as if heavy objects were burying themselves in the forest earth around him. At last, there came silence. Sam looked up cautiously. Within a few feet of his head, the ground was smoking gently. Cautiously, Sam reached for a stick and started to scrape away the earth. Within minutes, he uncovered the top half of a buried sphere, roughly the size of a football. The sphere was smooth, almost transparent. It pulsed and glowed with an angry green light. It seemed somehow alive. Sam reached out to touch it, then pulled back his hand. The thing was red hot. Hurriedly, Sam replaced the earth over his find and moved away. He'd come back again when it had cooled down in daylight. He set off for home. But Sam Seeley was in for an even more terrifying experience as he crossed the dark woods. Just as he came to a moonlit clearing, a strange wheezing and groaning filled the air. Sam slipped behind a tree and froze, as still as any rabbit. Before his unbelieving gaze, an old blue police box was appearing out of thin air. It took shape, became solid as he watched. The weird groaning sound died away, and the box just stood there, looking sad and lost in the moonlit clearing. Slowly, the door started to open. Not daring to move, Sam watched as a man came out of the police box. A tall, thin man with a deeply lined face and untidy white hair. Terrified as he was, Sam noticed that the man's old black coat and check trousers were both far too small for him. The man looked around as if in a daze. He looked straight at Sam, yet didn't seem to see him. Frowning with concentration, the man produced a key and carefully locked the door of the police box behind him. Then he took a couple of wobbly steps and collapsed. At this, Sam Seeley's nerve finally broke. He crashed off through the woods, running for home like a man chased by demons. Chapter 2. The Mystery of the Meteorites. Elizabeth Shaw was very angry indeed. It didn't help a bit that the tall army officer sitting on the other side of his desk seemed to find her anger mildly amusing. "Now see here, General," she began angrily.
"Just, Brigadier, Miss Shaw, Brigadier Alistair Lethbridge-Stewart, at your service.
Since you seem to be in charge of this silly James..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.